When some people think of Christian persecution, they hearken back to some 2,000 years ago and conjure up images of lions and Christians in the Roman Colosseum being fed to the lions or burned at the stake or hung upside down, crucified, and the like. Today, persecution of Christians is just as real, only it comes in different forms. We may not be facing actual lions, but the hostility is just as real. Today, the battle is fought outside abortion clinics, on the streets and sidewalks of America, in the public school classrooms, and in the courtrooms all across the country.
The AFA Center for Law and Policy was founded in 1990. In that time frame, there were very few groups that litigated constitutional rights on behalf of Christians full-time. We were one of the first into the arena, and thankfully, we have been very successful over the years. The idea behind the Law Center, though, that distinguishes it from other groups is we're not the biggest. We're not the one that you're going to hear most often in the media. On the other hand, if you want to stand up for what's right, if you want to speak out and be heard, and if you want to be successful in opposing the tide of the moral decay in this nation, then please call us. We exist to litigate aggressively, to litigate the issues that are fundamental to the foundations of this nation, and to try to turn things around for this nation.
We had firefighters from the city of Jacksonville come to us. They were forced to participate in a program through the city called Secrets of Successful People. That program was designed to enhance their productivity, make them better employees and workers. The difficulty with the program was that it forced them to learn Buddhist principles. It wasn't a question of just being instructed about what Buddhism is, but in fact they were told that to be successful, that they would have to actually get in touch with their Dharma. And in doing that, you become closer to God. Well, the firefighters that we represent are Christian men who believe the only way to be closer to God, of course, is to have a saving faith in Jesus.
And I thought, wait a minute, they won't let me preach Jesus Christ as a man of God, and yet they want me to follow Buddha. So I immediately told my supervisor, I'm not taking this class. I refuse to take it. He had not even looked at it, and he was a Christian himself, and he had not even looked at the material. He says, well, I've been given a direct order that everybody will take it, and I have to give you a direct order to take it.
When I came in to pick up a paycheck one day, they were talking about this, and Wayne was there and a couple other guys, and well, it was on your shift. And so they had me look at it and read it, and I said, I'm not going to do it.
The firefighters sought the relief from through their union. They sought help. They went all the way up the chain of command and were simply rebuffed. They explained that, look, this is contrary to my religious faith. It violates my conscience to force me to participate in this. And the city simply didn't care.
And the more we talked about it, the I guess the more umption that we got to go ahead and file a complaint.
We were left no other choice than to file a formal suit. We were issued a right to sue letter from the Justice Department out of Washington, and from that point, 10 of us have come together and said, you know, we're going to stand for what's right.
The firefighters that we represent include captains, engineers, at every level of the hierarchy of the fire department. They're all committed believers. I met with these men, and they were very much distressed at the fact that they were forced, on pain probably of reprimand and significant discipline, to participate in this course.
The truth is, the Buddhism thing was the non-issue to me. It's not going to radically change me or shake my faith. But what affected me most about this is that they expected me to take it and not respond when they want me to deny Jesus Christ. And I refuse to. I'm not going to stand for that.
Your only recourse now is to seek relief in federal court, preventing this from ever happening again, either to them or to future employees of the city.
When I first heard that I was being sued, I just, first of all, fear came on me because I didn't have a lawyer. I didn't know what I was going to do, if I was going to jail. And all I kept playing with my mind, what did I do that was so wrong?
We received a phone call from Carmen Vasquez back in 1995 that was just a shade less than frantic. She had every reason to feel that way because of the power of the government, the fact that she found out about the lawsuit on television. There's something very intimidating about sitting in the quiet of your own living room with your children next to you and with your husband, only to find out that you have been charged in a federal lawsuit by the most powerful government and the most powerful attorney general in the United States.
We started our ministry down at the Summit Women's Center in February 1990. After seeing that, we decided we had to do something about it.
We realized we definitely, this is a mission field.
Over 700 babies had been saved, and these were confirmed cases. These were not cases in which they just watched people walk away. These were cases where children were brought into the world, lives were saved who would not otherwise have been saved had it not been for Carmen Vasquez, Bobby Riley, Marilyn Carroll, and the efforts of these people who were involved in this pro-life effort. Now, because of that incredible success and the power of the abortion lobby in Connecticut, the United States government joined together with the Attorney General's office in the state of Connecticut and said, we want a test case. These people are too effective. And what they're doing, essentially, is they're affecting the business and the practice of abortion in Connecticut. So the lawsuit was brought claiming that the very passing out of gospel tract, this little 4'11" Carmen Vasquez, for instance, sought to hand a gospel tract across a person that was considered by the United States government and the state of Connecticut as blocking, impeding access. So it was a very important case from the perspective of the governments, because if they could use all the power of the United States government and the state of Connecticut against law-abiding, peaceful pro-life protesters, they could shut down all efforts in front of this abortion center, and they could, in effect, take it on the road and shut them down everywhere. We took it to federal court. In a full trial, we tried it. I never will forget, as we came in to the trial, there were three rows for the attorneys on the opposite side, the United States attorneys and also the attorneys general for the state of Connecticut. And then, of course, there were three of our attorneys from the Center for Law and Policy. We saw it as a watershed case for this center. Not only because it was critical in the pro-life effort to keep the gospel free in front of abortion centers and to save the life of children, but we also saw it as really a coming of age of this particular law center. We saw that God had raised up our efforts and our work and the commitment of these attorneys for such a time as this. We took it that way. We saw it as from the hand of God. And we devoted ourselves to it for 2 years. I wish we could say that when you go into federal court and you defend your reputation, the reputation of your clients for 2 years, you win the case against the most powerful government in the world, that they would simply leave you alone and follow the law. Unfortunately, that was not the case in Bridgeport, Connecticut.
We got down there and there was all barricades, there was five police cars, there was a motorcycle squad, a bicycle squad, and you would think what had happened down there.
The Bridgeport City Police Department began to apply certain laws against our clients under which they should not have been charged and threatened.
And they told us we couldn't go past the line that was painted around the clinic, and they told us we couldn't go 8 feet from the clients.
And they were telling the girls, oh, do you want to listen to that? Don't say anymore, they would tell me. She said she doesn't want to hear it. We're going to have you arrested if you say one more word.
What the Center for Law and Policy did is, on behalf of Carmen Vasquez and other pro-lifers, is to file a federal lawsuit against the city of Bridgeport against the particular abortion center there and others as well. Our clients won the case.
Well, I thank God for the American Family Association because I know without them I would not be where I am today, because they helped me a great deal to be able to reach the moms and to share the gospel out in the street. And they were to me like a guardian angel that the Lord sent.
And we're grateful because, like Carmen said, if we didn't have them, then the abortion clinic and the escorts and the government would have us off the street and we wouldn't be there to minister to the moms and to help save the babies' lives.
People come to football games at Penn State, you know, we're a national team, and they always remark at how wonderful this little town is. We have a real downtown. There's no sleazy storefronts here. It's a great town. Many folks don't even lock their doors. They feel so comfortable here. It's like some people say, they come in and say, it's like being in the 1950s again, where people are clean cut. They say please and thank you, you know, in the stores, and you get a good feeling to being in this community. And then we have the State College Area School District. Well, they, of course, are good people, too. And they're associated with this great town. And that is what's so odd about the whole lawsuit. That's what's so odd about this arrangement, is because these very good people in this very good town are doing some very wrong things.
David Sachs had three children in the State College school system. He himself was a member of the school board, had served on the local school board before, is an associate professor at Penn State right there in the town, has served on presidential task forces on standards for history teachers, and is an expert in his own league, a national expert on the teaching of history and teaching in general.
I had read some draft documents that were coming down the pike from the higher powers of the State College Area School District. And I was very worried. It looked to me that they had an agenda. They were going to bring in the kind of politics that would promote homosexuality and promote all sorts of other things that might stand in opposition to what people believe and what they're taught and their deep-seated faiths. And I wrote a letter. I went to the school board. I spoke out. And they ignored me. And they pressed ahead. And they put that policy in place. And what it essentially meant is that anything that you said, anything that was interpreted by the hearer to be offensive, anything could call or invoke the penalties of the rules. The way it was worded, they could take your child, put them in the principal's office, tell them that they had done something wrong, give them a penalty, and you as a parent would not even be notified. And in effect, the school powers could do whatever they wanted with the mind of a child. And that's so wrong.
We know how the speech code came together. We know the history of it. We know that it was people who were wanting to push sexual orientation, re-education in the public schools that brought it forth. So we feel like the speech code was their beachhead. If they could establish their beachhead so that you could be drilled out of that school system, as a student, as a faculty member, as a staff, or even as a parent, if you spoke against their programs on sexual orientation, that they could establish the entire their program in the entire schools.
And in this world where they use the word diversity, it's so odd that you can't speak your diversity, but they can speak theirs.
The policy went way too far. It tried to circumscribe a discussion about values. It tried to circumscribe negative comments about religion. And the court said, look, this has gone well beyond just trying to interrupt problems of harassment. You're saying that speech you don't want to hear is harassment. and we can't go there under the First Amendment.
I have four children, and I care deeply about them. And I work with young people on a daily basis. I go in and out of schools, and it's about them. This is our future. And if we don't act now, if we don't draw the line in the sand and work with these young people for their future, there will be great problems in this country, even more than we have now. So this case, what we did here, it was a small victory for me personally. But for what it meant to the rest of the country, this is something great, because the idea that any child can stand up in a classroom and speak out about who they are and about their faiths and who are their heroes and who they emulate and what they are as people, you know, how can we take that away from a child?
Were it not for the Bill of Rights, were it not for the First Amendment to the United States Constitution, we could be silenced.
In today's marketplace of ideas, Christian speech is not welcome in the public square. Indeed, it's even thrust out of the square, which is exactly why it was so important in the case that we represented Elliot Chambers in Minnesota.
Elliot Chambers was a high school student in Woodbury, Minnesota, suburb of St. Paul. He wanted to express his belief about traditional family values and human sexuality. And his message was simply a T-shirt that had two stick figures, a man and a woman holding hands, and the caption was "Straight Pride." He wore that T-shirt in the schools, and he was approached by a principal who told him that other students were offended by the message, and he was told that he could not wear that T-shirt to school again, and if he did, he would be disciplined.
Some of the background in that case is important to put it into context. The school had placed in some 50 classrooms the inverted pink triangle, which is the universal symbol for gay pride. In addition, there was a sociology teacher there who was actively indoctrinating the kids into the pro-homosexual viewpoint. The reaction to the filing of the lawsuit was quite enormous and surprising, frankly, to us. The local news media picked it up immediately. It was the top story on all three networks. In addition, we were quickly contacted by Fox News nationally, and they picked it up nationally. So it was carried on different networks and just really struck a chord. Perhaps that is evidence of the power of the public schools and how the Christian message in particular is one that is singled out for some adverse treatment in the school setting.
We filed suit in federal court. We were successful. We obtained a preliminary injunction. We eventually settled the case, and Elliot now is free to wear that T-shirt in the public school.
Well, the play depicted Jesus Christ as a homosexual who engaged in sexual activity with his disciples. It was very disturbing to know that Temple would tolerate a play such as this, since the school was founded by Dr. Russell Conwell, who was a pastor. Temple University was named after the Baptist Temple, which was Dr. Conwell's church.
So Michael is a young man of great substance, both intellectually and spiritually. He has started his own business, is quite successful with that. He was an intern in the West Wing of the White House, was a Dean's List student. He was involved with missions. In fact, he's frequently on missions, with doing medical missions, assisting medical missionaries with Feed the Children, doing all sorts of charitable activities across not only the country, but across the world.
I knew that there was something I had to do. I couldn't allow my Jesus to be depicted in a way and living a life that he was not. I was able to meet with the vice president of campus safety, William Bergman, and I was in his office, and we were basically discussing the production and my opposition to it. I made a decision that the best approach would be to allow us to have our own event at another location on Temple's campus, and to share with the students who the real Jesus is. And he immediately said to me that would be a very good idea.
Michael's case is an extreme example of what can happen to Christians who act on their faith, especially in the area of homosexuality. He took a stand, opposed homosexuality, not in an obnoxious sense, but simply in the sense of saying, this is Jesus, and that's not, that's being portrayed in the play Corpus Christi. And he was bludgeoned with that.
Vice President William Bergman called a week before we had scheduled the event, and during that conversation, I spoke with the director of campus safety. The director of campus safety, Carl Bittenbender, had told me that he needs to speak with me concerning the event. And then I went to the meeting around 10 a.m., and they had said that they wanted to discuss the stage with me, that it was too much money. And at that time, I had offered to pay for the stage. I said that we have already planned everything out, and we wouldn't want to see something happen because of a money problem. So he said that there was nothing else to do, that they weren't going to allow us to have the production and our event. That's when I was upset about the problem, and I excused myself and went to the restroom, where I prayed about what can I do now at this time. Almost immediately, I heard banging on the door, "Michael, come out of there, we need to talk to you." So I opened the door, and Vice President William Bergman put his hand on my shoulder and said, "Michael, why don't we discuss this a little bit further?" And I began to try to tell him that I believe our conversation is over. There's really nothing else that there is to be said. And that's when he began to use force to nudge me towards his office door. And I had said that I would like to leave. And he did not honor my request. In fact, he used more force to push me into the office and into the chair. So I began to get out of the chair, and that's when I was forced back down into the chair. And for a second time, I attempted to stand up, and that's when I was tripped to the floor by William Bergman, the vice president. Then I was tossed onto a couch in the office. And as I sat there, I soon saw a police officer who entered the room, and the vice president instructed him to put handcuffs on me. Then I was soon escorted downstairs out to an awaiting police car, and I soon found myself at the Temple University psychiatric ward. I was left there in the locked room with handcuffs on. When I was finally able to meet with Dr. King, who was the doctor, the head doctor at that time, and he asked me, what is this all about? He was kind of confused himself as to why I was there. And I went through the whole story of the event that we had planned and the cancellation of the event at the last moment. And he basically said, okay. And I was released from the psychiatric ward. But it was nearly 3.5 hours later.
If this can happen to Michael Markavich, Dean's List student, intern at the West Wing of the White House, entrepreneur, the list goes on and on. It can happen to anybody.
This incident has definitely caused me to realize how the spiritual battle, how much of it is actually there. And it has awakened me to think that these people went through this great extreme to put me in a psychiatric ward. And what for? What was the reason? To allow other students to mock and blaspheme Jesus Christ? I began to think about how many other people are out there and who have been in a similar situation where their civil rights have been violated and were without recourse. And just very thankful that the American Family Association Center for Law and Policy got involved in my case.
It boggles the mind almost to think that it could happen. But if we don't meet this with force, and if we don't meet it with a lawsuit and seek to have the university and those individuals who participated held accountable, then the floodgates will open, and they're beginning to open already. We're seeing what happened in a number of our cases around the country, and it seems as though the hostility is growing, and there's no longer the desire to shield it.
We currently have cases in San Francisco and New York where high-level government officials have unapologetically come out and condemned both Scripture and the gospel message. We exist here at the AFA Center for Law and Policy to combat these attacks on religion and religious freedom.
There are people out there who want to quash the Christian message wherever they can. There are people out there who want to indoctrinate a whole generation into their view of sexuality, their view of the beginning and ending of life, that is abortion on demand, euthanasia on demand. And if those people do indeed control high levels of our institutions, like the public school, it's easy for them to think their way is the best way, and they will quash all who disagree with them.
The fact is that the incredibly rich heritage that America enjoys, that has indeed given us the foundation for the freedoms that we currently enjoy, is being eroded and ultimately lost. We in the Center for Law and Policy want to recapture that vision. We want to instill it in our own children. We want to instill it in our grandchildren.
And every day when I wake up and I see my children and look them in the face, I know that what I'm doing is important and will have lasting value beyond today, but into tomorrow and the generations to come.
We also want to train up a new generation of lawyers who don't just dabble in constitutional law, but learn how to do this from the inside out. What we want to do is bring brand new lawyers into the Center for Law and Policy, train them in depth over a period of 1 to 3 years, including worldview, including litigation tactics and strategy, the whole package here, so that they can then spin out and start this project anew in their own communities, maybe carrying on for generations to come, if necessary, the battle that has begun right here.
There is nothing more important for us to protect than that right to speak the truth. And if organizations like the Center for Law and Policy do not devote themselves to that, then there are no protectors of the last great rights of free speech and free exercise of religion in public places.
The Center for Law and Policy is a division of the American Family Association. It exists to serve Christians whose First Amendment right to freely exercise their faith is threatened. AFA has been in existence for 25 years. The Center for Law and Policy has been in existence for over 10 years. During that time, we've defended the rights of thousands of Christians. The Center for Law and Policy does not charge for our services. Funding for this important ministry comes from the financial support of people like you. Your financial gifts make this ministry possible. We hope you'll consider financial support for the ministry of the AFA Center for Law and Policy. It costs us approximately $1 million each year to provide this important ministry. Please remember that as we protect the rights of others to practice their Christian faith, we're also protecting your rights and the rights of your children and grandchildren. We consider this service to be vitally important to all who love religious freedom and who want that freedom to continue.
For more information about the Center for Law and Policy, or for further information about our internship program, please contact us.